Live from Las Vegas, it's theCUBE. Covering AWS reInvent 2017. Presented by AWS, Intel, and our ecosystem of partners.
Hello everyone, welcome to day three of exclusive CUBE coverage here at Las Vegas for live coverage of AWS reInvent 2017. This is theCUBE's fifth year covering AWS reInvent, and what a transformation it's been. Rocket ship growth, they got the tiger by the tail, full speed ahead, they're not looking in the rearview mirror. This is the mojo of Amazon Web Services. They're kicking ass and taking names, as we say here in theCUBE, but really they're changing the game. A lot of game-changing announcements, architectural re-engineering, reimagining the future is really what they want, and they're trying to be everything to everyone. And of course, that's always hard to do. I'm John Furrier with Stu Miniman on our kickoff of day three, breaking down Werner Vogel's keynote, as well as kind of a review of what's been going on the past few days. There is a lot of signal here. There's almost a noise around the signal, meaning there's so much good content, it's really hard to get a hold of Stu. Great to kick off day three. Rested, didn't go out late last night, went to bed by 10. I know you stayed out till 3 a.m, but.
Hoping my voice can hold up for another day in Vegas, John. Good to see you, and I'm really excited. 3,951 announcements since the first reInvent. We're going to go through every one of them. No. Werner Vogel's, it was interesting because he's like, oh, we'd been told ahead of time, it's not going to be announcement heavy. Of course, there's some really awesome announcements. You know, I hate, we sound like fanboys sometimes, but you know, Alexa for Business, you know, the serverless marketplace, some really good segments from, you know, Netflix. They were just talking about iRobot, somebody, you know, I'd had on theCUBE earlier this year. But you know, Werner really kind of stepping back. Some people were like, what is this, a kind of computer science 101? But it's no, here's how you architect the future. Here's how Amazon's going to fit, everything from how voice is going to be a major interface to a theme that I've really liked, we've been covering for a number of years. Yep. You know, the digital future is not robots taking over the world, but how do I take people and technology, put them together to really create, you know, that explosive future? Because even the things like machine learning, the things that I've been talking to the people really in this environment is how are we going to train the people that are going to put these things together? It's not just, you know, something that just runs off by itself.
And we had Sanjay Poonen, who's the CEO, COO of VMware, not CEO, that's Pat Gelsinger. But he kind of pointed out something that I want to bring up here, which is Andy Jassy and the team at Amazon are highly competent and they're executing. But Stu, they're not just executing on the technical prowess, they're kicking ass on the technology. Certainly, I want to have a longer conversation with you about that. But they're really hitting some real high notes on societal change. So if you look at what Amazon enables, both at the startup level and the business transformation, even in the public sector with Teresa Carlson, who we'll have on later, they're enabling a new way to reimagine how they solve problems that never could be solved before. Two, they're kind of on the right vectors and it's causing some competitive ripples. Just today in the news, you can see stories out there in the Wall Street Journal and other places where Apple's partnering Stanford University to solve heart disease with the iWatch. Google's folding Nest back into the hardware division as pressure because their playbook's not working because Amazon's kicking their ass on Alexa and you got Siri. So Google's fumbling on that point. They're trying to figure it out. So you're seeing the forces start to line up in this new era of competing on value, competing on software, competing on community and open source. Amazon has the right formula. If they keep this up, Microsoft and Google will not be able to catch them. And that is so obvious. So until Amazon makes a misfire, which they have not yet, I mean, they experiment, but they're solid track record. We're going to call as we see it, but calling balls and strikes right now on the cloud game, there is not even a close second place.
Yeah, so John, you know, I've been searching for a word. We used to talk about a platform that you built, or the marketplace, or the ecosystem that we have around here. Amazon is enabling new things, the new AWS marketplace, enabling anyone really to go in there, really could do for, you know, cloud and technology what Amazon.com, you know, helped do for retail and business. You know, I'd say, look, not every single one of the features that Amazon had is leaps and bounds ahead of what a Google or Microsoft has. I know you've done lots of reporting on the machine learning and everything happening, you know, even Facebook and the like going in there. But you know, Amazon absolutely is in a class by itself, and it's still, you know, in our fifth year coming here, that they impress and they continue to keep executing.
Let's dissect the competition. Let's lay it all out. To me, the top three are no doubt Amazon, and then way distant second place, Microsoft, and then third on technology, and then kind of all kind of clustered in like a NASCAR, bunch of NASCAR clusters all trying to figure out what to do is Oracle, IBM, and everybody else. Okay.
So hold on. You didn't mention Google. You didn't mention Alibaba.
Google would be third. Yeah. Alibaba would be four, but their U.S. Yeah. presence, they're from before by sheer China volume.
Yes.
But Amazon's business in China is growing. They just cut a deal with China, so we're going to see that play out. We'll see, but Alibaba is a force we reckon with, as well as Tencent on Baidu and all those other platforms. But here's the deal. You can't be a pure play anywhere. Look at Google. The search engine business, they're milking that cow dry, but the thing is that the business is shifting. So I think Google, of all the competitors, probably has the best chance to accelerate, because I think innovation has to be at the heart of that accelerated leadership position. Two, culture. The culture of solving not just tech problems, too. And this is where I think Amazon, no one's really kind of unpacked this, is that if you look at Intel, for instance, they always have great tech and they always do good things. Amazon's kind of doing the same thing. They're solving societal problems, but they're kicking ass on the business front. Google has that DNA, it's just not organized into the machinery.
Yeah, I mean, John, we know Google has amazing technology, really good talent. I mean, things like Google Spanner, oh my God, this is amazing. The thing we'd say is there's things that Google comes out with and it's like, wow, this is really cool. I really need to think about a while how can I do it, as opposed to most of the announcements you hear in the sessions, people are like, oh my God, I can't believe Amazon did this. I can immediately take this. I can change the way I'm doing something. I can, you know, increase my agility. I can, you know, make my, how I just do my entire business different, better.
Yeah, and so Stu, I bring up the Alibaba comment. I want to bring that back in, because one of the things that Amazon's doing that Alibaba is kind of, emulating, is this notion of craftsmanship. If you look at the past 10 years, the programmer culture, the Y Combinator, the agile, lean startup kind of mindset, you look at a loss in craft in software development. Software development used to be a craft. You build software, we had a CUBE alumni from Apple that talked about, you build a shrink wrap product, you ship it, you QA, you ship it, but you don't know it's going to run. But in the agile, you're shipping, it kind of takes the craft and the artisan out of it. Yeah, UX could be cool, but I think now you're going to start to see a swing back, and whichever cloud can bring that artisan kind of craft and blend the open source kind of community model, to me, will be the winning formula.
Yeah.
Because that will change the game on these new use cases, the new user expectations, the new user experiences.
And John, that's exactly what Werner was talking about in his keynote, is this is how we're architecting the future. You know, everybody needs to be thinking about security. One of the critiques I saw is like, oh, well, you need to think about, you know, everything up and down the stack. It's like, you know, everybody needs to be the unicorn full stack developer, you know, understand security, be on top of serverless, do all this. Well, look, that's asking a lot as to, you know, not everybody's going to be able to do everything. Amazon might be everything is everything, but you know, we need to be understand, you know, how do we take the vast majority of enterprises out there and move them along? I loved, Keith Townsend and I did an interview with Chris Wolfe from VMware here at the show, and Keith said, you know, VMware used to move at, you know, the speed of the CIO. Amazon's moving way faster than the CIO. You know, how do we help the enterprises move faster? And it's tough.
We heard Intel saying they're moving faster than Intel.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Intel has to get in these reference architectures. So, with FPGAs and these new technologies, they have to accelerate and keep pace. But I think the Werner Vogel's keynote here is kind of historic to do, and you brought this up before we came on, was that he was not going to do a lot of announcements, although he did launch Alexa for Business on the Lambda services, all in on that area. He kind of did a throwback to 5 years ago, or 6 years ago, when he did his first keynote here, when he talked about the new architecture and reimagining it. But he took a modern version of what he was talking about then, and I think that highlights the Amazon greatness, but also their challenge. The one thing I'd be critical of Amazon is, well, two things. One is, I mentioned yesterday, Andy Jassy shouldn't be putting Gartner slides in a new guard presentation, because they're old guard. But that's one thing. But on what they're doing with the sales motion, it's hard. They have to convince customers and show them the new way. So what Werner painted the picture of is, this is how we're thinking. This is how you should be thinking, customers. You have to reimagine what was traditional architecture and think about it in a completely different way, which will change ultimately software methodologies, the life cycle of Agile, and hopefully bring in some, you know, value-oriented craftsmanship and artisan.
Yeah, John, and you know, so this reminds me of many of the waves we've seen throughout our careers. The customers, when they get in this ecosystem and they really start using it, they get religion. And you know, number one advice I hear from a lot of the companies I talk to, say, talking to your peers, what would you say? Say, get on it faster and really just dive in. It's like, yeah, you start with one application, but get off the old stuff as fast as you can. Get on this, because there's, when you have access to all of these services, it just transforms your business. You can get, you know, these changes in these services into more pieces of the organization. You know, John, we haven't brought up, you know, does IT matter? What's the role of IT in this versus the business lines and the developers? IT radically changing, Amazon looking to change that model.
Well, they are. I mean, there's no doubt, this show is kind of the final exclamation point on the fact that not only was it a collision course, it has absolutely happened. IT and Amazon have come together in a massive collision, and there's going to be carnage, Stu.
Yeah, John,
there's
going to be
people lying on the side of the road.
So question for you. I heard there's some people that are like, you know, this is the industry's biggest infrastructure show. And I'm an infrastructure guy by background, but I don't think this is not an infrastructure show.
No
this
way.
Is, you know, really about business. You know, absolutely there's technology. Somebody I love, they said, you know, CES, this is now EES. This is the enterprise, you know.
Well, I mean, we're going to have Teresa Carlson on. It's all digital, right? I mean, it's a digital culture because their public sector business is booming. It's not just the enterprise. They nailed the startup. They nailed the Elastic Cloud. Check. Tom Siebel pointed out yesterday. And what they're nailing now with IT is they are becoming the lever, the catalyst for IT transformation at price points and functionality never seen before, and it's mind-boggling. Google's got to reorganize because they can't compete with Alexa, right? Or things of that nature. So then you got the public sector, e-government, and then global, regional, China, Europe, huge issues. So they're winning. I mean, to me, this is a huge new thing. And why I rant on the Gartner slide that Jassy puts up is, Amazon is the new guard, and they're putting up old guard metrics. So Stu, this is not an infrastructure as a service magic quadrant. So the question we share is, what are the new guard metrics? My opinion, no one's developed it yet. So how would you define a modern metric for who's winning and who's losing? Because if you say number of customers, Oracle has a lot of customers, IBM's got a lot of customers.
Yeah, so John, Amazon's leading the vanguard in helping customers through digital transformation. I don't know how to measure that yet, but absolutely, you know, they're the ones that are doing this. It's not a product-centric, it's about the mindset and how we build things. You know, I've really loved this week talking about, you know, how real is serverless, and like, well, really, that Lambda's getting embedded everywhere. It's not about, you know, a product and, oh, hey, you know, you're only going to pay for it by the microsecond and it's 90% cheaper. No. It's about the triggers and the APIs and just integrating into the way I can build things faster. You know, yes, I can really, you know, get benefit out of microservices. That serverless application repository that Werner talked about, I mean, we got really excited when we got for containers, like the Docker Hub. We had, in virtualization, we had the same way we could get kind of standard images out there. Serverless application repository is going to do the same thing for serverless. You know, is there lock-in from AWS Lambda? How much is there going to be standards that come in? The CNCF next week.
Is it a cost reduction or is it a cost increase? These are questions.
Yeah.
All right, so final question for you. I know we got to move on to our full day here, but Stu, you know, you study it, you do the hallway conversations, you read all the influencer events. How do you connect the dots between Andy Jassy's keynote and Werner's? Where is the dots connecting? What is jumping out at you? Obviously Lambda, but what are the highlights from your perspective that you see just jumping out that Amazon's connecting and trying to present?
Yeah, so we always used to say it was like, you know, okay, is day one developer and day two enterprise? We're starting to see those lines blur. As the enterprise, we are still early in kind of the massive adoption there, but that's where it's coming together. There's, you know, lots of excitement, but, you know, as we talked about the continuum. We have bare metal, we have instances, we have containers, we have serverless. And the enterprise is starting to drop that. I know there's a Sumo Logic report you've been quoting, and we've been getting
the data on yesterday.
Out. Absolutely. So good data there. New Relic had some good reports digging into this. So the wave, you know, change is happening faster than ever. You know, Amazon, you know, is the lead horse in, you know, driving this change throughout the industry.
And don't forget Intel. Intel's just minding their business, just watching all these compute requests come in. I mean, as more compute comes out, Intel just, it's a rising tide, and you know, they're a big boat in the harbor there.
Absolutely.
All right, I'm John Furrier, Stu Miniman, breaking down day three of theCUBE. Day three here at re:Invent. Actually started on Sunday night at midnight. A lot of great action, a lot of great analysis. Of course, check out our new Twitch channel, so twitch.tv/SiliconANGLE, twitch.tv/theCUBE. Two new channels, or one rebooted channel, one new channel. And of course, thecube.net, we're on Ustream, we're on YouTube, but check out our Twitch and join our community if you're a gamer. Back with more live coverage here live in Las Vegas for AWS re:Invent after this short break.